Hey everyone, welcome to this video where we're going to take a look at GitHub Actions and see how we can use it to deploy our code to the AWS cloud. If you've ever launched a software project on the cloud, then you know it can become really challenging to manage as the project grows more complex. The key to managing this complexity is to automate as much of that work as possible. This way, we can keep our focus on the coding and maintain a high development velocity. We're going to learn how to do this by automating the deployment for an AWS project. We'll do this by using GitHub Actions to set up a CICD workflow. CICD stands for Continuous Integration and Continuous Deployment. This just basically means that whenever you write code and commit it to your Git repo, you have systems in place to automatically test and deploy that code. The idea is that you're always deploying code as you are writing it. This would generally help you launch new features faster, as well as making launches less risky because you're doing it more often, although with smaller sets of changes each time. Here's the tech stack we'll be using today. AWS CDK for the cloud infrastructure, GitHub for version control, Python and TypeScript as our programming languages. The project itself is going to be a serverless API written in Python. It's going to be hosted on AWS infrastructure, which we'll be managing using AWS CDK. Once deployed, it will have a public endpoint that you can access from the internet. We're then going to use GitHub Actions to create a CI/CD workflow so that whenever you push new code to the repository, the project's version number increases and the entire project is deployed or updated to the AWS cloud. If that sounds good, then let's get started. I'm going to start off by creating the AWS CDK project from scratch. But I'm going to do it quite quickly because this is not the focus of the video. The focus of the video is going to be when we add GitHub Actions. So if you just want to see that, or if you already have your own project you want to work with, feel free to skip ahead to the next section. Otherwise, feel free to follow along and create the project from scratch. So here I'm in a new folder, which I've called AWS CI/CD Tutorial. And I can create a new CDK project by using the command line. So the command is CDK init app, and then language TypeScript. Once it's finished installing, go ahead and open up the project in your favorite code editor. And you should see all the stuff here like this. So I've got my main app, AWS CI/CD tutorial, and I've also got this stack here, which is currently empty. So let's go ahead and add the code for that. I want to make a Python API that I can call over an endpoint. I'm just going to do that by creating a function, which I'll do it inside a Lambda folder. And I'm going to call the file main.py. Here, I'm going to have a function to handle the Lambda request. I'm going to call it handler. And it's going to return status code 200, and the body is going to be hello world. So now I want to create the infrastructure to actually host this function in the cloud. And I'm going to create it as a serverless Lambda function. And we're going to import Lambda. Now we can create a Lambda function in here. I'll use the latest version of Python. It's 3.9 right now. And we'll need a reference to the Python file we created earlier. So that's going to be Lambda code from asset in this folder here. And it's also going to need the name of the handler. So this is just going to be the name of the file, and then the name of the handler function. So main.handler is our handler name. Now to make this publicly accessible, I'm also gonna want to create a function URL. So I can do that pretty easily. Lambda has an inbuilt function to do that for us. This is how you can use it. This basically just adds a URL that we can call from anywhere, and it doesn't need any kind of authentication to call, so it's publicly accessible. I've also set the core's settings to allow any type of method and any type of headers and origins so that we don't see an error when we try to call it from a website. And to make the function URL print to the terminal when we deploy the app, we can add this output here as well. Now we have a very bare bones version of our app, and we can actually get started deploying it. So we'll go back to the terminal of the project and make sure that you have AWS CLI set up on your terminal and everything. If you're using CDK for the first time, you'll have to bootstrap it first. You can use this command and just replace the region with whatever region you want to use. And if you're not sure what region you want to use, then just use US West too. Bootstrapping will create a whole bunch of resources that CDK will need behind the scenes. You only need to run it once per account per region. So now I'm going to run Bootstrap for region AP Southeast 2, which is in Sydney. But because I've already bootstrapped it, nothing's really changed here. And that's fine as well. Once your bootstrapping is finished, you can run CDK deploy. And this might ask you a whole bunch of questions, so just press yes to confirm. And after about a minute, the deployment should be complete and you get this function URL here. If you click through to it, you should see the hello world printed out, which we've returned from our Lambda function. If you visit your AWS account, you should also see this new CloudFormation stack created by CDK, and it's got all your infrastructure resources that you need, including this Lambda function that we created with Python. So you can click through to it and you can see your code and everything. It's all deployed for us automatically. Now, typically as part of the development process, I probably add and commit all the changes I've made at this point. And I might even push it to my repo. If I go to my repo, I'll see my commit there with all of the changes that we just did. But now what we want to add is a workflow so that every time we push new code, the whole deployment process that we just saw in the terminal is done automatically for us from GitHub. To add a workflow, we're first going to have to create a new directory in our project at .github/workflows. And then we can call this workflow whatever we like. So here I'm going to call it deploy_beta.yaml. So once you have this YAML file, we'll start writing the workflow itself. First, we'll need a name for the workflow, and I'm going to call this deploy to AWS with CDK. And then we can specify the branch where this workflow will execute. So right now, we actually only have one branch, and it's called main. Every time we push something to this branch, this workflow will execute. But if you have more branches, like if you want to have a master branch, a prod branch, then you can write specific workflows for those as well. Next, we have the jobs section. We have this deploy action, and we're going to choose what platform to run this job deployment on. So here I've chosen Ubuntu latest, it's pretty standard, and then we can choose different steps for it to do. The first step we wanted to do is just check out this whole project into this environment. Then the next step is to set up Node.js since CDK uses Node. The next step is then to install the CDK dependencies. Basically, that's all this stuff here. So it's just going to run npm install on that. And for the last step of the sequence, I want to run the CDK deploy command that we did earlier so that our entire application is deployed to AWS. We're also going to pass this flag so it doesn't need any kind of manual input or approval. For GitHub to successfully deploy all this code to AWS, it's going to need a copy of our access key and our secret key. It's not a good idea to hard code this in our project because the project could be public or people could get a copy of this and then our account is compromised. So instead, we're going to use GitHub's secret manager and then access the key using these variables. Here, you can also specify the region you want to deploy in. So this should be the same region that you bootstrapped your CDK in earlier. Now let's add the AWS access keys to our GitHub project. Go to your GitHub project and go to settings up here, and then scroll down here and click on secrets and variables, and then click on actions. And here we can create a new repository secret. So the name of the secret should be the same as what we called it in here, which is beta AWS access key ID. So go ahead and copy that. Now I'm going to assume you know what your AWS access key is. If you don't, then pause the video and find out how to get that because you need it for this step. Once you have that, just paste it in here and then click add secret. Once you've done that, it should show up here. And also don't forget to add the beta AWS secret key as well. By the way, the reason I called these variables beta is because usually when I set up CICD workflow, I like to have multiple stages for my deployments. And the first stage I usually deploy to is a beta stage. After that, I'd also add a prod stage or maybe even a gamma stage, but that's not what we're going to cover here. So we just have this initial beta stage. So now our GitHub workflow is ready and our secrets have been added. So this should work now to deploy our code, except that right now we actually haven't made any changes in the actual code itself. And even if we did, we can't really see it from the endpoint because it's just going to say hello world. So let's fix that by making the body a little bit different. Now, instead of returning hello world as a string, I'm going to return a response body, which actually has the message and also the version of this API, which I'm going to start with 1.0.0. I've just pushed my code and you could see the third commit is showing up now. And if I go to the actions tab, you'll see that this workflow is actually running. If you click on the workflow, you can actually see all of the logs for each of the steps there. We'll see that it's set up the job successfully. It's managed to install all the dependencies, set up Node.js, and now it's deploying our CDK stack. After a while, the whole workflow should be complete. And if you go back to our app, you'll see that it should have our new code. So just refresh the page on AWS, and you could see that our new code is now deployed to the cloud. And if you go to the endpoint and hit refresh on that, you also see that the message has changed, and now we have a version number attached. Now, this is looking pretty good, but how can we make it better? Well, what if we made the version bump automatically so that we didn't have to manually update the version each time we wanted to deploy? This is really easy to do. We can create something called a git hook so that every time we commit, that number goes up a little bit. And then we'll have our Python file read that number from an environment variable and then update this when we call the API so that we get the version number increasing automatically. I decided I'm going to store the version as an environment variable, so I've created a .env file and I've set version to 1.0. I'll then need to run npm install .env so I can load the .env file. In the project itself, I'll import the .env file and then I'll load it at the beginning. So I'm just going to update my Lambda function to add the environment variable here. So now our Python should have this version environment variable accessible to itself as well. And now I'll replace this version number with the one that we've loaded instead. To make it increment automatically, we can add a pre-commit hook. So go to .git, and then there's a folder called hooks. The one we're gonna need is a pre-commit hook. So you can look at the sample to see how it's done, but I'm not gonna get into this. I'm just gonna show you the code and you can copy it into your own project. It's basically just a file called pre-commit, and it's a bash script. And here, all it does is figure out what the version number is and what the last digit of this version number is, and then increment that by one, and then write it back into the file. And by the way, I just asked ChatGPT to write me this, so I don't really know what it does either, but I think it works. Let's go back to our terminal and commit all these changes. Okay, and you see, I think the pre-commit hook works because you can see the new version being printed out and it's now 1.1 and everything's been committed as well. Let's go ahead and push this and see if it's reflected in our workflow. And as soon as I pushed it, I can see the new workflow running. Once the job is complete, let's check out our Lambda function again. If I hit refresh, you'll see that the code has been updated. And if you go to configuration and environment variables, you'll see that our version number is reflected here as well. And now we have an updated version, 1.1. So this is great because the versioning is done automatically for us as well. We don't even have to do that manually anymore. Now we can do things to improve our workflow even further, because if you look at this, we actually waste maybe 17 seconds each time installing these dependencies. But these dependencies don't really change all that much. We can actually cache them so that every time we run this step, we will use a cached version of those dependencies unless something's changed. Now, this is really easy to do in GitHub Actions, so I've added this extra step here, which is to cache the Node.js dependencies. It uses this action, cache v2, pass it in the path that we want to cache. So in this case, it's going to be the node modules, and here's the key. The key is going to be the hash file of this package lock.json, which only changes when we add or remove dependencies. When we get to this install CDK dependency step, we add a condition to only run it if we don't have a cache hit on this node modules file. So let's go ahead and add that. Now my new workflow has started, but it still installs the dependencies because we haven't actually cached it yet. This is the first time it's actually going to cache it. Let's go back to our Python file and change the message a little bit, and then we'll deploy it again. So let's do that. And then we'll push this change and see if our cache works this time around. So let's go back to the GitHub Actions page and look at the latest workflow, go and look at the steps, and you can see now that it's actually found the cache and it can skip this entire dependency installation step. Now, this is really useful if you have a step that takes a really long time for the workflow to complete, because if you can cache it, then it's much faster if you just load it from the cache. And of course, going back to the API, we can see that our message is updated and the version is updated automatically as well. So now we've set up a really bare bones CI/CD workflow system. Now let's really put our system to the test by making a major infrastructure update to our app. What I'm going to do in this update is to add a new database to our cloud infrastructure and then make our Lambda function worked with that database so that it keeps track of how many people have visited the page. It's going to be quite a major update. Let's see if our CI/CD workflow can handle that. So I'm going to import DynamoDB, which is going to be my database, and I'm going to create it right here. And I'm going to create this new table. I'm going to call it visitor timetable. I'm going to call the partition key just key, and it's going to be a string. I'm going to set the billing mode as pay per request, which means that I only get billed for any time somebody actually makes a write or read request to the table, which I think works out to be a lot cheaper. Now, the Lambda function will need to have access to this table, so we're going to pass in the table name as an environment variable. And finally, the Lambda function is also going to need write and read access to the table, so let's add that. Now my database is created in the infrastructure, let's go and modify our Lambda function to actually use it. Here I'm going to import the AWS SDK, which is in Python, it's Boto 3. And then I'm going to start by getting a reference to the table item. So we can do that by using Boto 3 resource DynamoDB. And we'll use our environment variable table name to get the name of the table and get a reference to it. Then I want to get this item from the table, and the key is going to be visit count. And if we get a response back, if we get an item, I'm going to set visit count equal to that value. Otherwise, I'm going to set it to zero. I'm going to increment the visit count and then write it back to the table as a new value. And then I'm also going to add the visit count to the response body so that when I visit this API endpoint, I actually see the total visit count. Finally, when you actually visit an API endpoint from the browser, it also sends a favicon request. It's the little icon that shows up at the top of the browser. So our endpoint will actually be hit twice. So here I'm just going to put in a little condition to make the function return if the path isn't the root path. Any other request to favicons or anything else will just return in a 404. And that should be my function. Look, that was quite a major change, but the whole idea of this is to actually check if the workflow can deploy this to the cloud for us. So let's go back to our terminal. Let's go ahead and add those and then commit those. Push. And as per usual, the new commit has created a new workflow, so it's starting to run and we can actually see the logs here. After about a minute, it seems to have deployed successfully, which is good. So let's go back to our endpoint and see if it works. So I'm just going to refresh the page. And now you can see I actually have a visit count here, and it's 1. And the version numbers increase as well. If I keep refreshing the page, the visit count goes up. The app seems to work successfully, and this number is read and written to from a database, and it seems to all be managed and deployed successfully using GitHub Actions right here. And if we just want to be sure, we can also go to our AWS console and actually check our CDK stack. And you'll see that the resources are here. We can go to DynamoDB, and we can see the new table that we just created, and it's even got the data inside. So now you're at the end of the project, and by this point, you should have a workflow that automatically versions and deploys your AWS application with each commit. If you want to look at the code for this project, then just check out the GitHub repository, which I'll also put into the comments below. And here's a little recap on GitHub Actions and how it fits into our whole workflow. So this is what your project normally looks like if you don't have CI/CD set up. You can push your project code to GitHub, and you can run a separate manual action to deploy your project to the cloud. But once you've set up GitHub Actions, you don't have to deploy to the cloud separately anymore. You can just push the code to GitHub, and GitHub will take care of the deployment for you. This just makes development a whole lot easier. Now, if your app starts to get really large and complex, you can take this even further. For example, you could have different workflows depending on which branch of the project you commit to. So if you want to have a beta version of the app where you're using experimental features, or you're just trying out things and you want to see if it works, you can set up a separate workflow to deploy to an entirely different AWS account so that you can experiment as much as you want from your beta stack that everything is working fine. By the way, if you've enjoyed this video and want to learn more about how to build a serverless API in Python, then check out this video where I show you how to host a serverless Python Fast API app on AWS Lambda. Otherwise, I hope you found this useful. Let me know if you have any questions or comments. Thank you for watching.